life, dissect it the best that we can in about 15 minutes and possibly glean some wisdom. Okay. But to begin with, harmony, where did the idea for something like this come about? Because there's so many lost arts. You're going to places in India that most of us have never even heard of or seen before. Where did the idea come from?
So the germ started with the producers contacting me saying that they want to do a non-fiction series and why not something on rare musical instruments. And being someone who loves the arts and travel and music and dance and everything, this was something that I immediately jumped into. And there was already a possibility that Mr. Rahman would be part of it. And when that talk started, I was also very keen that there's always this mindset that documentaries or non-fiction series can be boring or too informative.
Oh yes, everybody says that.
Yeah.
You ask your friends saying, shall we watch a documentary? And they're like, really?
Yeah, so I wanted to break that myth, but at the same time make it informative, bring out things that even I don't know about. So we put a big research team to scout for the most interesting stories, because it doesn't stop with just the musical culture, but I was also looking at interesting people behind them, the musicians, their stories, their personal struggles, because at the end of the day, whether a person's watching the series loves music or knows music or not, the thing that would connect to them is human emotion. So I wanted at the end of the day it to be a human story. So we did a lot of research, filtered through many musicians, and we were particular that it should be across India, it should be at least one woman should be in the list.
I guess that's what happens when you have a female director planning things, you start including more women.
Yeah, and their stories, I mean the presence of the musicians and their genuinity and a lot of things, factors brought harmony together. It was a harmony in itself.
But speaking of musicians, Madras, you say musician, we always think of the Mozart of Madras, A.R. Rahman. What was it like working with that man?
A word to say is surreal for me initially, because I have been probably Rahman sir's biggest fan, a quiet biggest fan. Like, hey, he was like a mentor for me.
Hey, I'm very sure we're all going to compete with you for the title of Rahman sir's biggest fan. What do you say, guys? See? So you can take national awards home. We're competing with you on that title.
Yeah, but I maybe like how Ekalavya is like, okay, you're my guru, but I can't see you, but I'll keep following your work. But it was amazing. Of course, the first meeting was surreal, but after that, when you meet him, he's a person like anybody else who has so much passion and love for what he does and to collaborate, and there's no ego at all, and which was amazing for somebody like me. I'm like, oh my God, you're an Oscar winner, and here I am, just an upcoming director, and I'm asking you if I can do this. And he's like, why are you asking me? You're the director. Go ahead and do it. So, and he was very encouraging. And one thing he taught me, or I learned from him, is that one should never compromise on the quality of work that you do. And there was something he said that, you know, the minute your product leaves out of the studio or from wherever, it's out to the public and you can't take it back. So make sure that it comes out well. And that's the lesson I take back.
So let's talk about the documentary that you made that got you the national award. Let's talk about A Far Afternoon, because I see a common thread that runs. There is a love for music. There is a love for nature. There's a love for art. But how do you translate doing something like this and before that, coming off of a award-winning documentary to this?
So the thing is, though my first film was A Far Afternoon, which was a documentary, my learnings came from working in mainstream commercial cinema, where I had the fortune to work with the best DOPs, the best editors, and as you know, mainstream cinema is all about entertainment and visuals and the music and the dance, and I love all of them. So for me, when I wanted to translate what I learned into documentary, because I didn't go to film school, it was all something I learned on the job. When I was thrown to make A Far Afternoon, I didn't know for a minute, like, how do I go about making a documentary? Because the process of making a fiction film is very different from nonfiction. And everything, starting like whether it's, you literally script everything on the edit table in documentary, but it's the other way around in commercial cinema or
and
like
also for
films.
Most of us as Indians, we have a lot more exposure when it comes to commercial cinema.
Exactly.
When someone dreams of making movies, they dream of making mainstream movies. Nobody dreams of making a documentary.
Same here. I started off watching films at Satyam Cinema and being drawn into it and wanting to be part of this world.
There are a lot of butter popcorn fans there. I see a lot of claps going on for that.
Yeah, so when A Far Afternoon happened, I had to unlearn everything I knew about what I knew about filmmaking and to see how do I now start translating my story in a nonfiction format. And that's when I realized there's a lot of what I learned that that I wanted to incorporate in nonfiction. Whether if you see A Far Afternoon, there is this sort of hero introduction kind of thing I would do because Krishan Khanna, who's the protagonist, is such a charming, adorable man. And I didn't want to just start the film showing him like that. So I just showed his eyes and just the back of his and then just his voice and then revealed him. So I think
it was very unusual for a documentary. Like I'd never seen an entry like that. Like I kind of wanted to whistle and I don't know how to do that.
So, and again, we had a small segment where it was purely musical and nothing else in Far Afternoon. So those kind of tricks, I mean, it was probably not tricks at that point, it was the only thing I knew. I was trying to translate that in nonfiction. And of course, the whole point of making sure a nonfiction can be entertaining as well. So when it came to Harmony, especially when we have somebody like Rahman sir, and we are going to be on a big platform like Amazon, I wanted the series to reach out to a lot more people. And when you're traveling around India, it is only natural to show the beauty of it. How could you not show these beautiful places the way we had to show it?
So I feel like you're the new ambassador for Incredible India. That's absolutely amazing. But speaking of films and filmy entries, I feel like your story, your journey so far is like that because, and if I were to give it a title, I'll call it The Internship. Because I feel like every pivotal point in your life, every milestone has started with an internship, right? Can you tell us about that?
Internship or not, over time, maybe at that point I was not wise enough. Now I sort of believe in what Rumi says, what you seek is seeking you. A lot of things in my life, I knew I wanted to get somewhere, but I didn't know how to get there or what were the exact steps to get there. Or maybe I did have certain plans of saying, no, I need to do this, need to do that. Sometimes they don't work and that disappoints you. But thankfully for me, over the years, the universe has been very kind. It has been giving me a lot of opportunities. And when these opportunities come, I immediately grab them. And I take them really, really seriously and make sure I do the best out of it. Starting from
the college internship in Miss Chennai.
Yes, so Miss Chennai was when, I mean, I never thought of myself to be a pretty girl or a model material. I just went to the organizers and say, hey, I need to do an internship. Can you give me a job? And then they said, you know what? Why don't you participate instead? And I was like, me? I mean, can you see me? I'm in my grandfather's kurta walking into your office. Am I model
looking
material?
Looking at you right now, no one can believe it, but I feel like you pulled a Miss Congeniality back then.
So, I don't know. So, I think they saw something in me. And for me, at that point, okay, let me try out something. Okay, I don't know how to groom myself. I don't know how to walk the ramp. Maybe this would be a good training to do that. So, I took that up. But even after that, it was for me, okay, I've taken the responsibility of finishing my education. Let me do that. And the next internship was at K. Balachandra sir's Minbim Bangal. We were working there. And then KB sir noticed me again. And he wanted a girl just to do one role that, to translate something similar that Suhasini ma'am had done in Sindhu Bhairavi. And again, who could say no to KB sir? So, and we were like, okay, it's just one episode, let's do it.
I'm seeing a pattern here, because life seems to be giving you options and choices, and you always say yes and you try, and that's how great things have happened
yes,
for you.
Yes, as I said, the universe has blessed me with these opportunities.
Conspiring to make your dreams come true, like Paulo Coelho likes
yes,
to say.
Yes, yes, totally. And yeah, so after that, KB sir, it was just supposed to be one episode, but he liked it so much. He even named the character Sruti, very close to who I am. And he created a full character in the whole series, and that's how my acting career started. But these were good things for me because they were an entry for me to understand how this film industry worked, because coming from a typical Tambram family, and we had no connections to cinema, we never even went to the film theater as a family. We were so away from it. We thought it was like people from a different world would be part of it.
So then how did this switch happen? Because you've been in front of the camera. I know you've done about 300, 400 ads. You've acted, you've done theater. And more often than not with performers, they come with an ego. They enjoy the attention. And then when you switch to being behind the camera, there's a switch that needs to go off in your brain as well, and not an easy switch to make.
Somehow I've been conditioned that way, or that's how I work. So even if it now, when I got the opportunity to make Harmony, I sent out a mail to all my family members saying, I won't be available for any family function or any of those things. I'm not going to be the good daughter-in-law or the good daughter for the next 6 months. So I think that switch comes naturally because people also tell me, oh, you do so many things, you multitask. But I look back and I realize that I don't actually multitask. When I take up something, I put all my focus into just that one thing, and it could even turn into obsession sometimes. So I think that switch comes naturally. So it's also a sort of dedication or a sort of fear that, oh my God, I need to do this job properly. So when I work as an assistant director, I switch off and don't even think that I'm a model or anything. Like even now, Mikma's group said, ma'am, we didn't recognize you at all because they've seen me in my tracks and t-shirt, tanned and tired. And so at that point, when I'm doing something, it's a whole different mind frame based on what I'm doing. So if I'm in front of the camera, there's a different mind frame. When I'm behind the camera, there's
so there
a different
faces
mind frame.
Is Shruti. There's the model face, the actor face. And so my one final question to you would be, for most of us, when we were growing up, our career options used to be being a lawyer, being a doctor, you know, maybe being a chartered accountant, being a banker. That's about it. We went to watch films. We never thought that we could either be in films or even make films. So how do we go about changing that? How do you think it's changed today?
Definitely in the last, I've been doing this for the last 10, 15 years, and I see a lot of change already because films have become a little more accessible nowadays than before, or film people, anybody in the film industry. Like, I get so many people messaging me on social media saying, I'm interested, what can I do? They're having easy access to talk to somebody who can advise them about this
and
industry.
And are you open to mentoring people if they reach out to you?
I would love to, because when I was growing up, as I said, cinema felt like a different world. I didn't even know if this is a career choice or if I was capable of doing that. And thankfully, I had my little entries through modeling and acting, so it gave me a little window into this world. But nowadays, and there were no YouTube or things like that. If I wanted to watch a foreign film, I had to make sure I was there at a film festival or buy mm-hmm. some pirated DVDs, which I couldn't afford at that time. So right now, I mean, we have the access to these things. Cinema has become a lot more accessible. But yes, there is still a lot of mind block on what cinema is. I'm sure not every parent would say, oh, go ahead and make cinema or be part of this industry. It does have a fear associated with it of some kind. But
hopefully
I think
the people who heard you talk see that you have a square head on your shoulders and you're a great example, and they're going to let their kids go as well. But I want to thank you.
Thank you
for making yourself accessible for people out there and being open to mentoring. Ladies and gentlemen, can we please give Shruti Harihara Subramanian?
Thank you.
Thank you.